नमस्कार दोस्तों, मैं हूं आपका होस्ट रॉनी और आज के वीडियो में सभी का स्वागत है। दोस्तों, आज के वीडियो में हम लोग बात करेंगे पॉकेट इंस के सीईओ और चीफ टेक्निकल आर्किटेक्ट के साथ। एंड गाइस, दिस वीडियो इज ब्रॉट टू यू बाय cryptocentral.io। दोस्तों, आपने अगर मेरा यूट्यूब चैनल को सब्सक्राइब नहीं किया है, उसे आप प्लीज सब्सक्राइब कर लीजिए। एंड गाइस, यू कैन ऑल्सो फॉलो मी एट फेसबुक, विच इज www.facebook.com/earnwithronnie। गाइस, आई एम with the Pocket Inns team. We have Mr. Amol Sharma. He's the Chief Technical Architect, right?
Yes, that's correct. I'm Chief Technical Architect.
And we have Mr. Sarvaji Madha, who is the co-founder and CEO of Pocket Inns. Right. So I'm very much honored to have you guys and do an interview with you. Let me start by, you know, sharing some experience, what kind of experience got into this field. Maybe a little background about yourselves for our viewers will be great.
Sure. Basically about me, I have like around 14 years of experience in this area. You know, I've been working in the IT field, like I said, for 14 years. Pretty much has been my bread and butter. So I have been working for various companies like Barclays, JP Morgan, etc. You know, and prior to like starting Pocket Inns, I actually worked for Barclays as a senior vice president there. So my job was basically taking new projects, scaling it up across multiple countries. So
like I mentioned, you know, it's pretty much this is what I've been doing in this area, and I started Pocket Inns like 2.5 years back with Smita. Amol, I think he can talk and provide some introduction about himself, you know, what his background is.
Right. So I'm Chief Technical Architect on Pocket Inns. I have about basically 12 years of experience in the IT. I started with basically the web development, building the e-commerce site for people, big companies in the US like Home Depot, Coach, like that. And then I moved to the machine learning and then also augmented reality and virtual reality. So my experience is pretty much very diverse across the fields. Almost a year back, I got a call from Sarva saying that, you know, I'm working on this thing and I know Sarva for a long time. We've been talking and he told me that, okay, let's work on this one. And he's been working on this Pocket Inns for almost some few years now. And I was really impressed by what he has developed. And then he said, you know, we are going to add the blockchain part of this into this. Then I said, yeah, sure, why not? And then that's how I got in, started with Sarva. And my experience on the blockchain is almost 1 year now when I started working on the Pocket Inns.
Okay, that's great. And it's great to hear from you. You guys have a vast experience in the IT field and also working for big corporate houses. So I believe it's going to be a very good project. And also what I like about the project is that, you are planning to have the entire suite of products and services which we could buy under one roof. So I'm just imagining stuff, right?
Right. So, you know, the whole concept, you know, there was a purpose of this. And the issue is how the whole level of internet right now, you know, the system of working that is currently on is, you know, because it's more verticalization that is happening. And verticalization is, you know, a certain amount of business is just, you know, certain amount of companies just actually having access to it. You know, there is no decentralized point that is there. You know, if you look at companies like Airbnb or Uber, you know, they're not really peer-to-peer service. They're just a set of just, if you look at it, you know, they're just an aggregation service. You know, what they're doing is they're a centralized service. They're taking your information and pushing it there, and they're taking a bunch of money for that. You know, and what they're doing is with the money power that they're getting, you know, they are just controlling the market by itself. You know, they're gobbling up the smaller ones. So, the end result is that, you know, it's the customer who's a loser in here, you know. And as these corporations keep growing bigger, and you have seen the example with Amazon and what's happening now, you know, where Amazon was in 10 years, now it's just eating on every single area. It's eating on its competitors. It's trying to dictate terms even to the customer. You really don't have a choice in there. And the customer, you know, one thing we have seen is really doesn't know he's getting his things as long as he's made to believe that, you know, he's got all the things he wants, you know. That's what it is. It's like Maya, literally. You know, that's what they want to create. You know, they want to make sure they give a little bit and, you know, take a lot. You know, that's how it is. And this is where, you know, I was not really happy with the model. And you know, I was exploring, you know, getting into this business for a while. And I started realizing, you know, when I actually first came across blockchain through Bitcoin. You know, it was it was a coincidence for me. And you know, when I, and Bitcoin was fascinating, you know, when the Mt. Gox happened, you know, if you were very familiar, the 2013, you know, what really caught my attention was you know, Bitcoin, the technology that it was built on, you know. And I started researching in 2013 for almost like a year and a half till I was comfortable to see the potential of what it could become. And you know, I realized that, you know, the technology is not where we are. I mean, if you look, even today, if you look at most of the companies that, you know, we are pretty much, the internet was in like 92, 93, 94, you know, this is the phase where we are in. So we are at the right stage, you know, where the it's just going to keep on getting bigger, and it gives us ample time to build ourselves, you know, a serious company like us, which has been in the business for the last 2.5 years. And, you know, we struggled a lot, you know, especially me, my co-founder, because when we actually I floated this company, you know, my goal was to first build a company. It was the old school way of building a company first, a product first, you know, rather than doing an ICO. But within a year and a half time, things changed a lot, you know. Like, I mean, I wanted to do an ICO in 2016, but we had challenges in completing the product because, you know, the capital requirements and all those things, you know, that were really, really pushing us back, issues in terms of integration and the partner issues. So we faced a lot of problems during those phases, you know. But the end goal was always that you know, I wanted to make sure that I would go with at least a product in hand, you know, a live product in hand, so people can see the value. But after that, it just became, you know, I was really surprised the way ICO took off, and all you needed was a white paper. You know, I mean, today companies are raising millions and millions of dollars, you know, just with the white paper. You know, and it's more about how you market your ICO than about the real product today. So, I mean, the value addition that we created was in building the product first. You know, there are a lot of work to be done, because, you know, it's still not at the level that we would like to. And that's the reason why this ICO money is going to really help us take it to the next level. And this decentralization is basically handing out power to people, you know, like you, me, and the common person out there. What it can do is just create immense value for everyone. You know, these multiple marketplaces that is there. You know, we the goal is that, you know, we have a certain amount that we want to be raised in the ICO, but we see that it shouldn't stop us over the next couple of years. Even if you raise a decent bit of amount, we're opening, we plan to open a development center in India now, a proper center that we have in-house employees are working with us full time. So that will automatically shoot up the value also, proposition that we have, in the quality, because we have control over the quality also of the people we hire. And that's where we actually, you know, want to come in and establish ourselves as a good company out there, and not just like any other company.
That's great to know, Sarva. So how the idea of this pocket-in scheme, it's mainly because of giving power back to the people. And we all know...
Well, you know, see, theoretically, it wasn't just that, you know, it was more in terms of a vision on how the whole system was, you know, I first, and my basic thought out of this was that, you know, I had this thought that, you know, because of the verticalization of the process and everything that was there, you know, with Amazon taking such a big, huge control, literally every aspect of their people's life, I started seeing what could happen in the next 5, 10 years, 15 years, 20, if this kept on persisting, right? Small businesses will die out. You know, people will not have control. Amazon can pretty much dictate their terms, you know. You, no matter what, I mean, today they have started dictating terms, or for that matter, anything. You look at Uber or Airbnb. Once they establish their market share, you know, they can start doing anything they want, you know. So and that's where we started, you know, seeing that there was a need that, you know, we had to take these things back. You know, there had to be some kind of a level of a competitiveness that, you know, we can bring about, where people can also start working in the same manner, you know, without compromising on the quality and the service. That was very important there. And that's where, you know, this idea came in, that, you know, I really wanted to build something, but I was looking for a technology also that could really help me elevate that. And that's where I came across blockchain, you know. Initially, when I started thinking about doing something like this, you know, technology that would help me, you know. I was saying, how can I use the internet? How can I do it? Because end of the day, then I need to have the right monetization model. You know, how can I really leverage something where it can be cost effective, you know? Because now if you look at it, the entire operations is in terms of, you know, the goal was to have it been driven by the community in terms of the level of scaling and everything that we have. It's a pretty ambitious project that we have, you know. But we also, like I said, you know, how it had to be managed, because, you know, I was seeing it at both ends too. You know, we had absolute a lot of capital, we had minimal capital on where we can actually take it further, you know. And at both levels, we are still sustainable. That had to be the key goal. End of the goal, it needed to exist to provide maximum value. But if it is not maximum value, at least it should be at a level that will provide minimum maximum value. You know, that right in between. That balance had to be established there. So that's how we are trying to push it through too. You know, that's our end goal. You know, and giving people control in what they want to buy, how they want to buy. You know, everything, security. I want people to control it. You know. So tomorrow, if I'm having this connection, Zoom is actually probably taking every bit of information on how, where it's coming from. We do not want to give that information, you know. So Zoom is basically outlining how much, how many video calls you've made, every single bit. So this shouldn't be happening, right? It's you taking control of things by yourself, because that's your privacy. You know, you're doing multiple calls and all those things. They are trying to utilize it for their own personal needs. So this is what I want to take it apart. So there has to be no controlling factor. You exist in a playground, you do what you want. You know, we want to be the gatekeepers of that alternate economy that we're building. You know, so that's why I personally don't like to call it a collection of marketplaces. You know, what we call it as an operating system for an alternative digital nation. You know, that's the way I call it between ourselves. You know, because that's how the ambition is there. You know, people can do what they want in there. You know, easy accessibility, whether it is a guy sitting in a village, you know, doing pottery, he can sell it to a guy sitting in Paris. You know, that is the end vision. You know, anybody should be able to do business anywhere without any compromise from a middle person. That's it.
And denying the fact, I believe the big, richest person in the world right now is Mr. Jeff Bezos.
Yeah.
So definitely a huge opportunity we have. You guys have, we all have. So coming to my next question, which is regarding your initial token auction. And this is something very unique, which I haven't heard in this industry so far.
Yeah.
And, how you got your project registered with the SEC?
So initially what we did was we wanted to make it a very compliant. You know, we are a US based company. You know, we wanted to follow things very legally. That was the first thing. You know, one thing I started noticing was in the last couple of years was the pre-sale thing that was happening. So, and people really don't realize it for a long, long time. And it's basically, you know, giving discounts, and then, you know, when you have a discount, so it's, I mean, look at, you'd offer me a $1 worth of share for 50 cents. I'm going to dump it the very first, second day, you know, it's in the market, because it's going to give me profit. But that's what happens, you know, there's no value really for an actual investor. And, you know, there are a lot of, it ends up hurting a lot of investors than actually benefiting anyone, you know. So we just wanted to avoid that. And even right in the beginning, we knew it was a very big risk, you know, because see, the market, we saw that is always the number one factor is driven by greed. You know, nobody cares about how right you are or whatever it is. You know, we still face issues. People telling us why you didn't do pre-sales. You know, why didn't you do all these things? So we get scolded even for that. You know, so you can see that doing the right thing was also not the best thing to do in the market like this. So when we came across, we decided that being in the US will follow all the SEC procedure, like that would go in for an IPO. You know, so we pretty, you know, we said that, you know, whatever the compliance is required in there. So we filed ourselves as a SEC 506C. It's for accredited investors only. So, and yahan pe kya ho jata hai? If you look at it, you know, majority of the population, you know, just dissolves in there, you know, so that people who can afford to lose their money, only it comes in. That is the whole purpose of having an accredited investor, you know. So no, it's not for everyone, basically, you know. It's not for someone who's, you know, has like $1,000 or 1,000 rupees at home and he's trying to gamble it on this, you know. So we wanted to ensure our investors are protected in there. So we designed a strategy in such a manner that every single aspect of it is covered. So the SEC was the first aspect. So we filed it, filing with the SEC like just before a few weeks before the token auction started, and now we'll be filing our Form D in the next couple of days once the auction ends. So we will be a proper securities offering, and you know, we will be probably be one of the compliant ICOs out there. You know, and we are pretty happy and proud about that. See, whatever money we raise, we know that we can create a lot of value out of it. You know, we are not some kind of a company today that is going to take the few millions and, you know, just go play around with it. So we are very serious about what our plans are establishing. From a scaling standpoint, we need to see how the amount of money raised from there, we'll see how we can go about it. But at the same time, we are trying to look at an area where we can avoid the seed round and the series A round, you know. Then we can bring it to a certain level and we can still get venture capital money, you know. So that's also something that we can aim. So there are multiple aspects of it that we are looking at, because, you know, the vision of the project is pretty big. You know, we want to create an internal economy, which means that, you know, these marketplaces, we want to create its own financial system. You know, it's and then, you know, the spins currency will be the core operating currency with it for these entire markets, you know. So it's not like a gimmick currency, you know, the blockchain is actually utilized in here. You know, we charge zero commission to sell me something. You have to sell me a car. You don't have to pay any middleman any money. So you don't have to pay pocket in any money in there, you know, any commission in there. Because all we do is we charge, like, you know, like your, if you're familiar with Netflix, you charge a monthly subscription fees, you know. I mean, that would be basically be refunded if you transact over a certain period of time. Because end of the day, we have to keep the platform stable and we have to keep monetizing. We will be taking small cuts out of here and there, you know, small things that are there, you know, additional. You know, for example, if a person like is doing some kind of an advertising there and he gets a lot of advertising on his site, we just share it. You know, we take maybe like a 20%, 30% instead of taking 100%. You know, so that's how we want to do that. You know, we have multiple monetizing models also, actual realistic monetizing model. You know, so like I said, you know, we are pretty much on the path. We know exactly what, how we have to go about it. It's the capital is only the one thing that is keeping us back, you know, and taking control of it from our perspective, where we can quality people that we require, you know, this ICO really helps us do that, you know. That's our end goal.
Yes, the ICO space has been booming, and there has been a lot of scams also, and we can see AC cracking down on many ICOs which have taken place.
Yeah.
So definitely, it you know, gives the investor a new look that, see, there is an ICO which is coming, which is regulated with the SEC. So,
very frankly speaking, you know, it really, because a lot of these ICOs are pretty smart. You know, they have their lawyers. You know, they are out of the country, from some godforsaken country they are registered in. You know, they know how to play around with the rules also. You know, after we entered this space, you know, we realized that you can still get away with all those things. See, investors are like lambs, you know. They really don't know what's going on. They don't understand legality. He's just interested in making a quick buck and he wants to be out, you know. You don't get too many serious investors in there, you know. And that's why it's our job to protect them. A lot of things, you know, we are hammered on Telegram with people who we realize that they don't understand it, but it is our duty to help them keep informed. You know, from our end, we tell them how we need to do. We never push our investors. We never tell them, no, you should invest in us. We never tell them that. The first thing we tell them is, this is your due diligence. Our job is providing you information. You know, you have to take the time to do your due diligence, understand what we are doing. And then if you feel you are right, only then invest in us, you know. So we are not that desperate, you know, to bring investors of, you know, any kind in there. We want to ensure people are totally secure in any ways. And if you read the white paper, there is a lot of time and effort gone in that to make it very detailed.
To add to what Sarva is saying, one of the reasons that I joined this project, because Sarva actually, every single step made it so open and transparent, and in every single step he made it everything legal. Because there are so many scams in the ICO market right now, and he's been very proactive in actually approaching the SEC and then making the things right way. Even Dutch auction, actually, as he explained, you know, is very, very right and fair to the investors. So no one can actually say that something has been gone wrong into this ICO from the legal point of view. And that actually makes me proud and the whole team proud as well.
Yes, definitely the ICO space, as I was sharing, we have different kind of ICOs, and ICOs raising money which they don't need. That is again a big issue. So definitely we have a lot of ICOs which are coming there. But let's now talk about more about Pocketins, and what could be the future of Pocketins in 10 years? What is the vision you have?
Is to get the Pocketins.com. You know, we have around already in the European market, but we are seeing some site stabilization issues. So we are going to go back with the money that we have. Once the whole ICO distribution and everything is done, you know, we get it listed on the exchanges, and all those things are done, I'm heading to India to look for a place to set up the development center. So that's our first priority that we are doing, and hiring people. and then getting, you know, moving a consulting. So right now, most of them are consulting with us for the last couple of years. You know, keep pulling the good ones inside and start moving up the quality level. And same thing with the .com site, that we want to keep pushing it up. And we're going to be adding more properties also. So we are on standby. We want to launch in the US. You know, we have like around 250,000-300,000 properties. But, you know, there are a lot of regulations in the US for us to start selling our properties here. So that needs to be established. So once we go back, we're going to start reworking on the site, you know, take like a couple of in a better manner, and then start pushing it out with much better properties also out there. I mean, I'm really looking to end this year at least at around 750,000 properties out there. So which means that these are properties that are actually available on an Airbnb or in a different home away kind of environment, but Airbnb charges like a 12 to 16% commission, where here it's 0%, you know. So that's the value addition that we want to provide in there, you know. And since now the other part comes in is the integration of the PINS tokens also in that. So that's going to be the next aspect of it, because I know in the next 4 to 5 months, you know, the mobile application is pretty much out there, but we want to introduce the iOS and Android together. And we want to make sure that, you know, the PINS currency is also part of the system also. So right now we're using Braintree as a payment processor temporarily, because it's a partial application of the blockchain right now. But now we want to get it in completely, start offering the benefits, start adding more marketplaces. You know, we are planning to do car rental service, and we're going to create an e-commerce store. I mean, with the money that I currently see us ending in, I would say, you know, these are the three main key things that we're going to be adding over the next couple of years and building the business, you know, a full-fledged from the travel front, from the e-commerce front. So you can see us doing a lot of stuff over the next couple of years, and then maybe going for more venture capital funding there, you know. Establish there, create a lot of traction, you know, and start generating revenue. That is going to be the next main goal. Over the 10 years, you know, it's a long time for a startup to think about at that level, because I normally say that, you know, what happens to a startup after a year or two, you know, we never know. You know, it's still a startup. So 10 years is a long, but the way I would like to see it is that you see it yourself as an established company, you know, having an IPO, you know, you know, basically having an entire ecosystem out there where people see it as a much more value-added option than other existing businesses out there. Created a dent in the business, and people start seeing the actual value in what we created. You know, that's what I really like to see it over the next 10 years.
So my next question is regarding the, you know, reverse bidding, and how will it benefit the customer? Because I see all your marketplaces, which are going to be added to Pocketins, will have this feature called reverse bidding.
Right. So the reverse bidding is a brand new option that, you know, I personally designed it myself. So and this basically is something that it came in very specifically. So, you know, in this area especially. So before I come to reverse bidding, you know, so we also wanted to create some innovation in terms of the existing how the tour travel industry works. You know, right now you actually, if you look at a hotel or you look at a vacation rental, they give you a time to check in and at the same time, right? So basically, the first day when you come in, when you're traveling on the first day, the time you check in is not always the right time. You know, you're probably trying to come in early, or you're checking in too late. So the money is basically wasted. And the same thing happens when you check out, you know. So it's actually, when you look at it, it's an entire day wasted when you combine it together. So what we did was, we are trying to work with companies and with, you know, home property owners, to ensure that, you know, we can get in a check-in at request. You know? So let's say you want to check in at 4 p.m. in the afternoon. We should be able to do that, you know, because the whole goal is that, you know, you're not in a hotel, you're in a vacation rental center, and you're booking it prior to that. So you should have the liberty to actually do that, because you can do the kind of customization that is required. Maybe not out of 10, you know, you cannot do all the 10, but maybe at least 4 to 5 of them. So we wanted to provide them that value option there. Right there, you have an immediate saving without even 3 days worth of savings. You're staying for a few days in there. And then you have your day stays and overnight stays. That is something also that we have thought about, where you just need to just come in for a day, stay there, just take off. Same thing, just overnight. You know, you're just, let's say, for instance, you're just in Bombay for a day. You spend your, you know, day just working around, overnight, just stay, next morning, take off. And that's the purpose, you know. You know, the business, complete business is based on value. You know, that's what it is created. Now, the reverse bidding aspect of it is also similar like that. So what happens is, if you look at the vacation rental business, I noticed that it was that, lot of the better looking homes are the ones that go in every day, Okay, so the good looking homes are the ones that get sold every day, and they're normally listed on the first search page, result page. You know, that's pretty much there, and people just look at that. There are also homes that are much beautiful there on the other pages, but the inventory is never really taken in. So I thought, you know, these things need to be brought into the highlight, you know. So, and the best thing, I said that, okay, for example, Ronnie wants to book a place. He just says that, listen, I'm ready to spend $500 today. I won't spend more than 1,000. So there could be an owner who's charging like around $1,000 for that per night. But because he's in the third or fourth page, nobody's actually seeing him. And he says, hey, Ronnie wants this place for $500 for the next 4 or 5 days. My place would probably be empty. So let me get value out of that. And let me just bid for that, you know, for the $500. So, like you, there'll be multiple people. You know, they'll just say, like, okay, this is $500 he has. Let me just bid for the entire, for his business, basically, for your business, basically. So, once that bidding is done, you know, the person who has bidden first, based on the timestamp, right, gets the business from you, you know. So, in this side, you're basically getting a $1,000 worth per night property for $500. Our property owner is getting like $500 for the next 3 days, you know. So there's value created on both ends. So inventory is also not gone waste, or the property owner gets value on, and you get value on your what you're paying for, you know. And that's the whole purpose of reverse bidding in there. And that's how it was conceptualized, you know. And this is something that I want to utilize not just across this platform, but across multiple platforms.
So yes, then the question comes, because then there's the, you know, building the community part. What are your plans of you know, building this community? I read that you already have around 1,000 people in your community.
Yeah, so we have a good number of people in the community, but you know, it is for sure that, you know, we are not going to be raising 20, you know, 50, 20 million, 30 million. That is for sure. We realized that early on. Because and maintaining that kind of community requires a lot of you know, back end also, so and it will take a focus away initially, you know. But what we intend to do is that, you know, we are going to have a digital team that we are going to set up in house, and they'll be taking care with this. So what we intend to do is work with the community, give them regular updates, you know, and start a separate system for them. For example, well, the community dashboard will be ready probably, I would say, in another year. I would say another 12 months is what our estimation is. The requirement offering will start in the next couple of months. And we'll be looking into it to see how best we can start building it ASAP too. Yes, you know, community is going to be one of the major aspects of it. But how to bring it into the system is how we need to decide. You know, because again, it's operational also. So the first goal for us is to bring the marketplaces in. Because the community ultimately has to also contribute to that. You know, the goal is also that, you know, because over the next four or five years, if you look at it, we want to push the community as also an alternative for employment. That's what we are looking at. You know, so they come into the site, they can actually contribute, and if they are contributing at a certain level, they get the pins tokens. You know, that's where the community mining aspect has been created. We haven't created mining just like that. So you contribute to the platform, you start getting value, and it is value for the investors also, for everyone out there. You know, so it balances out in the right manner. You know, the community is going to play a very, very key service, but it's going to take at least like a year to put it in place, because it's probably going to be a very big project by itself. You know, the community mining part of it.
So we spoke about the, you know, how you are going to increase the community. So now please share more about how the community mining is going to happen with Pocketins.
Sure. So we designed it was that we didn't want it to be just another mining option that, you know, anybody in any Tom, Dick and Harry will set up with a GUI machine and then start mining us. You know, we wanted to give that option also to genuine contributors to our ecosystem. You know, and so we designed it in such a manner that the miners will only be the people who actually contribute, you know, to the system. And from then onwards, they can actually assign it to someone else. You know, they can do what they want with it. But the first step is that they have to contribute to mine. The best way to say is how that can happen is it could happen in any area for that matter. And so if you remember, was that Pocketins, in the way we are visualizing the future, because of the vastness and the scaling of the project, you know, we want the community to play a much major part in our development, you know, because that we can take care of it from the technology standpoint. But we also want the community involved in it so they can take care from the outside, the offline world standpoint, you know. In the real world, you know, how, what is required, you know, good support is there, development is there, a lot of marketing that comes in there, you know, word of mouth. And adding properties, it could be, or you know, just ride sharing services, you know, bringing their car rentals into the picture, you know, for peer-to-peer sharing services. So anything that they come in, this is where the community mining comes in, and they have to be validated with by providing them the PINS tokens, and that's why the we have kept a, such a decent bit of you know community mining tokens just for them, you know, so that when they get it, the value is not just like they are getting it; it's value also for the investors who are invested in this auction, you know, because as they keep contributing. And they're getting their token goes up, you know, because they're contributing a lot to the platform, you know. So simultaneously, it's a win-win situation for both the investor as well as the community miner, because they will be invested in the project, and for the investor, it's what he actually set out to do, you know, get bring value to his tokens in there, and the value of the currency also remains stable in there because it's a constant generating factor within the ecosystem. That and an example would be that you know. You know, so today, you know, the way the companies work is that, you know, they hire multiple programmers. You know, the way we see it is that, you know, tomorrow, let's say, we, instead of hiring 10 programmers, I'll probably hire, you know, a person who knows to just to have a like an X number of stories written and say that, you know, this needs to be developed, this needs to be developed, this needs to be developed. And instead of that guy going to Upwork, we just put it on a community mining platform and say that, hey, you know, we need these things to be code to be developed for this project, you know, and these are the X number of requirements. Each, so the community team picks up one, you know, each one of the stories and they develop it. Unity itself basically says that, you know, okay, this code is the best so far. You know, they upmark the quality of the code and everything. And the best quality of the code is pushed into the system, you know, and then we take it for a QA, make sure there's no bugs, security issues, all of that, we put it in together, and then we push it into a system. So if you see the value, it's like, you know, having an American Idol for the world, you know, on the tech level, you know, that's what we are doing. And the same thing applies to even for a, like a question for a support. Support a person is going to another vacation rental home, you know, and he doesn't recognize the place. So there is always someone around him to actually facilitate that for him, you know, the option where he can take a call, more localized options, understand it and you know, provide a much better service and experience. So if you look at the quality levels and service level also goes up in there, you know, and that's the kind of value the community power can create in there. It's absolutely amazing. The value addition that can be created with all of this comes together, you know, whether it is marketing. Imagine the number of people I can have access to, the word of mouth in there. You know, they say, hey, Sarva, you know, I did this. I've actually facilitated this after getting approval from the marketing team. This is where I put the ad and I generated so many visitors to the site. This is where it comes. So the marketing, the community is not just having some kind of a Telegram member or something. It's much more than that. The way we have, you know, we want to create a ripple effect, you know, it's like, for 1% of the work, we want to see 100% output. That's the end goal in there. So I hope gives you a fair idea of what community mining is right now.
Yes, what I understand, it's going to be a pool of opportunities for the
people. Absolutely, absolutely.
Willing to contribute to Pocketins.
Absolutely, like people are doing it for free right now. Here they get value in there. So, and for value, you get good quality, you know. So there is no level of quality compromise in what we do. So whatever you see on, let's say, on an Amazon, they claim, we can have the same things on our side too. There will be no quality compromise because the community themselves will be to ensure that.
Okay, that's great to know. And coming to revenue, how Pocketins is going to generate revenue? We see that you are going to charge a subscription model. Do you have any right. other models which are planned for the revenue generation?
So currently that we have looked at it is from a subscription model. That's the best way that we can leverage a blockchain. Aspect of it, because when you're having a collection of marketplaces, we are also looking the way we analyzed it was that, you know, it's like the challenge of, you know, when Netflix came out with movies, you know, and they said that, you know, you just have to pay $8.99 a month and you can access and see any number of movies you want. So that's the same thing that we are trying to do in here. You know, we give you an option that you have access to every single marketplace of your choice, you know, homes that you want, you know, cars that you want to rent, you know, or stuff that you want to buy on the internet, you know, without anybody, you know, policing you. So you just end up paying a decent bit of fee, a monthly fee that is there, just like you pay You know, that's what we aim to do in there, because it creates a lot of value. But in addition to that, you know, we have to keep scaling also. You know, we have seen, because it has an internal financial system also, so we intend to do some charges on that. You know, that's where we really can leverage some charges in terms of, you know, interest, you know, peer-to-peer lending, loans, you know. So those are the areas that we can start charging some money, and we can start making some money on that front. And there are multiple, because, you know, the vastness is of the project is pretty big there. We also have the option of doing a lot of advertisements that is needed, but sharing it well, but making it very fair end of the day, you know, because if I'm going to share it with Ronnie, I'm making sure that Ronnie gets like 90% of it, and we'll keep 10% of it. You know, so that's the end goal in there. You know, we keep a very small percentage of it, because we ultimately, it's a company, it's a business, and it needs to run. You know, if it's not scalable, it's not profitable, then there is no value for anyone right there.
Very, very true. Very true. What are the, you know, future challenges or hurdles which you think could come in progress of Pocketins?
So the current, very frankly speaking, you know, see, I've been working on this for a long, long time now. You know, almost like I quit my job in like in 2015, and I started this company. And the major challenges come in terms of, you know, the kind of resources that are there. You know, capital. You know, our hard cap for this was almost like $46 million to build it over the next 5-6 years to keep us comfortable. You know, but after the first month or so, we realized that, you know, we are definitely not going to hit that. You know, to be very frank, there was no pre-sales. We didn't offer discounts, all of that. So the large-scale investors pretty much ran away, you know, because they knew that we are not going to do a pump and dump for them, you know. So now the reliance is more on the community that we are working with. So with the community, its own set of challenges, you know, people, you know, having adequate knowledge of what we are doing, how we are building it, you know, technical know-how, all of this come in fact. We have to take a lot of things, you know, people have a lot to say, but end of the day, you know, we are experts in our field, we know how to best get it done. And the challenges is that how we can get about it, you know, start building the product, making sure, you know, nothing stops us in getting the job done. We have the first marketplace done, now we have to just get it better, you know. So, you know, the first main important thing I told you is that, you know, scaling up the properties in there, giving people more options, launching in the US, plus in the Middle East, in India. That's one of the main things in there. And then moving into car rental services, you know, those couple of areas that we want to quickly move into. But it also comes with, you know, hiring people on the blockchain space. So initially we had plans of hiring like, you know, 15-20 people. We wanted to like, you know, collaborate with multiple universities, you know, lot of things that we thought about. You know, we have to scale back on a lot of things right now. You know, we have to look at it. But end of the day, it's not stopping. It's probably this is the way I like to put it. Instead of things happening on day one, it's probably going to happen on day three, you know. So instead of things happening with 100 people, it's now going to happen with like 10 people. That's the way we see it. But it's still going to happen, you know. Instead of, like I said, the first 2 years, it will probably take 3 years or 4 years. Simple as that, you know. So we are a very bunch of persisting kind of a people, you know. And we are aware that, like I said, the technology is that we are at a very good time and a very good phase over the next 5 to 6 years to build a good company, you know. We still have the option. And this time we have a decent amount of trades. It's not that we are doing very bad. We are like one of the top raising ICOs right now in the market, especially after the crash, you know. So, you know, that is the community has been there to support us, you know. That is one of the biggest plus factors. And so the challenges, like I mentioned, is what you see in their resources, you know, little challenges. If we are establishing it in India, we are going to establish it in tier two cities. You know, we are looking at right now. We are looking at Mangalore is where we are looking at to set up. They have a very good extensive pool, a lot of engineering colleges around. So we also are talking to from a regional engineering college called Suratkal Engineering College. If you're very familiar with that space, so they have a very good R&D team that we want to work and set up with, because we are also planning on building an own protocol on that. You know, we're going to move out of the Ethereum blockchain, because that it won't really support us in our ambition and our dream. So, you know, building our protocol is going to be one of the main steps that we want to take in that too. So yeah, so there are quite a bit of things, like part of any startup, you know. But the challenge is to just keep moving forward. You know, things are going to keep coming anyways, one way or the other.
Very true, very, very true. And with this kind of a vast project, you can definitely expect these are very nominal hurdles which would be coming your way.
Yeah.
Definitely.
And I've been through worse, you know. So, you know, I invested my own money, me, my co-founder, and Smita, when we all put in, you know, it was our own money that went into it, you know. So I know what it is. You know, we have our angel investors who invested. It was a stealth project then, you know, that we actually, where we actually did. So, and the blockchain wasn't very cool then, as it is today. Nobody even knew what blockchain was. So I know what life was then back then. You know, I never used to talk about blockchain technology. I should just tell, I'm just trying to change the world with this marketplace, you know, that can give you so many things. So, yeah, but today, you know, it's changed a lot of things in there. And it's just about going there and getting the job done, you know, whatever comes in a way. If you have to do it 10 times, you do it 10 times. If you have to do it 100 times, you do it 100 times. It's as simple as that. You get it till it gets done, you do it. That's how I work.
Awesome. So, finally, what advice would you like to give to our subscribers before investing in any cryptocurrency or ICOs?
Well, you know, it's difficult for me to I personally don't like to, meddle myself in somebody's investing affairs, because, you know, people have different reasons, you know, for getting into the whole investment thing. But what I keep telling people is that, you know, take your time, understand, do your due diligence, you know, take time to understand what the founder's background are, you know, because right now when I see, a lot of them, you know, almost 90% I would have to say are like have been created overnight. You know, the company has been created in, if you look at it, September, October, November, like last year, you know, 3-4 months, they raised some pre-sale money, push in big in the marketing, create the hype, and then raise 30-40 million, you know. So that's the modus operandi that is there. So I think, you know, the reliance they say on team is becoming less, and the way people marketing, the glamour of marketing is more. It's like a bad movie marketed well. You know, that's the case also, you know, but so really with no content, but just, it's just a case of good marketing. That's all it is, you know. And, you know, I would say take a look at companies which have good products in hand, you know, that are not just in an MVP stage. It's very easy to create an MVP and fool people, you know. So be very careful. And most importantly, do your due diligence. That's very, very critical. You know, you have to take a decision based on what you think, not based on what others think, you know. Take time to do that. You know, it doesn't just happen overnight. You know, having somebody else do it for you, it doesn't make any sense. There, that's the best thing I would tell your subscribers there. And it's the same thing with our ICO too. You know, we tell them, take a look at us, take a look at our team. You know, how we have built it. You know, we are not an overnight company. You know, we are not a white paper based company. We have been building this for the last two and a half years. You know, it's our own money that has gone there. We haven't taken a single paisa from the pre-sales or from the investor to do our advertisement. Nothing. You know. I can proudly say that, you know, our team members have put in our own money with this ICO, and we're happy to have come out of it that way. You know, the money that the investors put goes to the building the product itself. So that's the best way I could put it across.
Okay, great. And any final, you know, things which you want to share about Pocketin's main features? Just some key points, just to sum up.
It's a collection of marketplaces. What I would say, you know, it's a kid having a lot of candies, you know. That's what I can say. You pay for, you know, you have a time. You pay for, they say, pay for one candy and you get a lot of others. You know, that's it's pretty much, that's what I like. It's like being in the playground. You have everything you need, and there's nobody to control you. Your dad and mom are kept outside the playground. That's the best I can say. You can have all the fun you want, you know, but you need to do it in the right way, because there's still daddy watching you outside. So that's the best thing I can say in there. It's a great product, great service. I know I've got a great set of team. The core team is just incredible. You know, we got an amazing set of advisors. We got people to actually build this in the right manner. It's just now from the capital standpoint also, we should be good to go in there. You know, and we look forward to having the community support us. You know, we are like a couple of days away from ending the ICO. You know, today's Sunday here. So we're going to be ending it on Wednesday morning, 10 a.m. EST, New York time. So, and that's probably around, in India, it's around in the night, I guess. I mean, 7:30 in the night, or 8:30 in the night. So 8:30, it will pretty much be done in India too. So after that, it's back to the drawing board and the building pocket, it's there, you know. So we want to take time, and we really do not want to take time in spending too much on raising money, so which is why we kept it only for 16 days.
And this is what you don't see in a lot of ICOs.
Yeah.
How was your experience with the Crypto Central team?
Oh, I mean, so I've been interacting a lot with Kashif, and the one thing I would say, I mean, the speed of work is, it was amazing. You know, that's what I really was very, very impressed. So by the time I, you know, we were very busy with the ICO. In between that, you know, these guys came in and I was like traveling a lot. I was getting a lot of work done and everything. I forgot a lot of things was lagging from my end, but the way these guys, I were actually following up with things, and within a span of 2 days, you know, I mean, right now we set it up in like Friday, it was done, and these guys took care of everything, and including your video, the way it came out so professionally, so very well done. It was just incredible. Great experience. Fantastic. I really have to compliment the Crypto Central team.
Okay, that's great to know. So wishing you all the best for your ICO, sorry, your initial token auction, and definitely I also want to participate in the Pocketint's ICO as well as in the community, because I myself, you know, I started doing e-commerce. So, okay. And I left because of, you know, these marketplaces like Snapdeal, Flipkart, they are so unfair to small sellers. So I had to forcefully shut down my business. But definitely with my sources are still there, and with Pocketint, I will definitely try when you launch their e-commerce platform. So I'm also looking forward to your project.
We look forward to having you on the platform, sir. It was great having you and great talking to you too.
Same here. Nice meeting you, and wish you and the entire Pocketint team very, very, very best. Okay?
Thank you. Thank you, Daniel.
Thanks a lot. Thanks.
Hello, bye. Good night.
दोस्तों, आई होप आपको ये इन्फॉर्मेशन अच्छा लगा है, तो डेफिनेटली दोस्तों आपका प्यार दिखा के ये वीडियो को लाइक कर दीजिए, एंड आई विल सी यू इन माई नेक्स्ट वीडियो. अंटिल देन, बाय बाय फ्रॉम रॉनी.